Hello and welcome. You're watching Property Hotline with me, Kavita Krishnan. We are slowly but surely entering tax season, and I'm sure all of you have many queries related to taxes and property. With filing and paying taxes comes a long, long list of formalities. And we have an in-house expert here who's going to answer all your taxing questions tonight. So feel free to call us on the numbers flashing on your screens. You can also mail us your questions, and you can even post your queries on Facebook or tweet them to us. You want to be seen as well as heard? Send in a video query to feedback@mbnow.in and we'll get that answered. My guest for today is Ashish Sodhani. He's an associate international tax practice at Nishith Desai Associates. He joins me in the studio. Ashish, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Kavita. How are you doing?
So let's start. We start with a question that's come in on email, Ashish. Sure. Sagar has written in and says that his salary is 6.5 lakh rupees per annum. He's applied for a home loan and he wants to know if he should invest in any tax saving investments along with that.
Right, so I think firstly this is more of a investment question, but from a tax perspective, what he should consider is that the loan amount, the principal amount that he will be paying to the bank, he should be able to get a exemption of about 1.5 lakh rupees on that from his income. With respect to the interest amount that he is paying, if this is a residential flat that he is investing into, then he should be able to get a 2 lakh interest exemption from his income every year.
Okay. And also, I mean, he doesn't tell us, he's not given us those details. But if you were to, you know, you already have a home loan, you're living in a house.
Right.
And if you have another house that you've invested in, I believe it is more prudent from the tax perspective.
Right. So when it comes to you having a second house and taking a loan for that, in that case, the full interest amount is allowed for exemption under the Income Tax Act.
So is there a cap on that?
No, there is no cap on that. Your full interest amount that you are going to pay, you on the second house is eligible for deduction.
So if you have a second home, you can actually claim the full interest amount as deduction. 100% of the interest that you pay can be claimed as deduction. So yes, real estate is not just a smart asset, it's also a very prudent asset from the tax perspective. Let's move on. Sudhir Grover, I believe, has called in. Sudhir?
Yeah, my question is that I have booked a flat which is valuing more than 50 lakhs.
Mm-hmm.
And now I have received a letter from the builder, that is TDI, Kundli, mm-hmm. that I have to deduct TDS from the payment I have paid to them,
mm-hmm.
and give a TDS certificate to them. Since I am not very clear of this process, I need clarity on this. Thanks.
Okay, the builder has asked him to pay TDS,
right,
and present the TDS certificate to the builder. How does he go about it?
So, I think his first question was whether he needs to pay TDS. Yes, you need to pay TDS.
So, any property I buy, I have to pay TDS?
Right. Any immovable property you buy, you will need to pay TDS. The rate is 1%.
There is no cap on the value of the
property?
Yes,
so I was coming to that. He, in fact, mentioned it himself. The value is more than 50 lakhs.
Hmm.
And if the value is more than 50 lakhs, that means you will have to go and pay TDS at 1% on that. Now, coming to the formalities with respect to payment of TDS, they're fairly simple, actually. There is no requirement of a TAN, or there is no requirement for even filing quarterly tax returns, withholding tax returns. All you need to do is that there's a special form called the Form 26QB. You can go online also and fill that form. That's the challan that you need to fill up and pay your tax along with it. The tax would need to be paid on the 7th day after the month in which you have paid the installment amount to the builder.
Mm-hmm.
With respect to the certificate for tax deduction, a Form 16B will need to be filled up and issued to the builder.
Can Sudhir do this himself, or does he need to, you know, go to a CA or something? Is it as friendly as filing your income tax returns now?
Well, I think it is. You can go online and do this. You just need to register online and you can fill up the forms yourself. They are fairly simple.
They're fairly simple, you're saying. So, you said you can go online. Where can you access these things online?
So, the income tax website, incometaxindia.gov.in. Once you enter there are a list of procedures that you can follow there and get onto the PAN, TAN and all the other forms that are available. You can fill up them.
And the certificate, how do you get that certificate? So, once you fill it, the certificate is sent to your address?
No.
Is that how it works?
So, you can take a printout of the certificate and
give it to
the builder.
Okay. So, Sudhir, those are all your questions answered. And the good news is it's not very complicated. You can actually go online and you can fill it yourself, get a printout and give it to the developer. Right? Let's move on. Let's take an email query now. Narendra says that his younger son wants to gift his elder son cash worth 30 to 40 lakh rupees. Now, I would love to have brothers like that. His elder son wants to buy a property with that amount. He wants to know if the elder son will face any tax liability on this amount that he's been gifted.
All right. So, first of all, there is no gift tax in India. But when you receive an amount as a gift, you are taxed as income from other sources. So, what income cannot go under the other five heads of income under the Income Tax Act goes under the income from other sources.
Wait, you've lost me over here. You say that tax, there is no tax on gifts.
Right.
But if you're gifted money, like here the elder son is getting from the younger brother, if you're gifted money, then you have to pay tax on it.
So, I'm saying if you are gifted something, you need to pay tax on the under the Income Tax Act. But there's a specific exemption available to a relative. If a relative gives a gift to another relative, then you will be exempt from paying tax on that amount.
Okay.
The relative is defined as spouse, brother, sister, mother, father. So to all these people, once a gift is made or between each other, the gift is, there's no tax applicable. And once the brother receives the amount, he is free to do anything with it.
Okay. And do you need to go and prove it with any kind of papers or something? Do you need to declare it when you file your tax returns?
Yes, you need to declare it that you've received that amount and it is, and the exemption is available to you under Section 56 of the Income Tax Act. However, having some documentation in place would generally be helpful.
So, brothers, what kind of documentation will help you?
You know, even a one pager saying that, you know, I am gifting this to my brother.
Affidavit, that's what you're saying.
Yeah, something like that would also be fine.
Something like an affidavit. So, yeah, so Narendra, essentially, your younger son can gift money to his elder brother and the elder son will not have to pay tax on that. But like Ashish said, it will help. It makes sense to declare it when he files income taxes. And also there is exemption available. Claim that exemption that you're getting and also, attach a one pager affidavit saying that you got money from the brother. Right. Let's move on. There's another email question. Now we have a lot of email queries coming in today. So Chandra has written in and he says that he bought a plot in his wife's name a long time ago in Chennai. He wants to sell the plot and buy two flats in equal amounts. He says he wants to register one flat in his name, the other in his wife's name. Can he do so? If yes, who should he declare as the owner of the flat since the sale proceeds will come in his wife's name? He asks if there is any tax liability on this and how can you go about this transaction? It's quite a complicated one.
Right. So, coming to his first question, that whether he can, since he's getting the money in the name of the wife, whether he can take two flats, one in his wife's name and one in his own name. So ideally, that should not be done. Since the money is coming into her name, the two flats should be taken in her name only.
Okay.
Now coming to the second part with respect to how to do the transaction. So if the first house is a residential property, then he will be given the tax exemptions wherein the income received from the sale of the plot of land, if used for purchase of a residential flat, then it will not be taxable. Now, with respect to the second house, since while these exemptions are available to him, if a second house is taken, which is a residential flat or used for residential purposes, then all exemptions available to him for the first house will not be available. So therefore, the second house should not be a residential house.
So you're saying what he can do is invest in a residential property and probably a commercial property.
Right.
So he can buy a flat and a shop, but he can't buy two flats.
No, he can buy two flats, but the second flat cannot be used for residential purposes. As soon as he declares something second to be used as residential purpose, then the exemption that he is getting on the first will not be available.
Okay. So he buys a flat, but he says it's not residential.
It can be an investment property. He can rent it out. Hmm. And what he can also do is that the wife could gift the second flat to his husband.
Okay.
So that will also be not a...
So buy both flats. That's what you're saying. So essentially what you need to do is buy both flats in the name of your wife. And a smart thing would be for her to gift one flat to you. Because gifts, like Ashish told us, are not taxed by the Indian government. The other thing, of course, that you could do is buy two flats and show the other flat, the second flat, don't show that flat as residence. Instead, show it as an investment, right? That's it with that. We have another email query that's coming in. Sanjeev has written in and he says his mother is a homemaker who's about to receive a lump sum amount by way of inheritance. Now, this lump sum amount is coming from the proceeds of an ancestral property sale, which is being equally distributed among his mother and her siblings. His mother does not have any other source of income. She doesn't have a PAN card. What would be the tax implications of this windfall income? Is the tax treatment same as proceeds from any other typical property sale, or would it be different since it is inheritance? And how can she save taxes? That's our favorite question.
Right.
And does it make sense to create an HUF account in this case? And does she also need a PAN to receive this amount?
Okay.
And should he get it now or before filing the tax returns? So what should he do?
All right. So let's break it up. I think there are too many questions here.
Inheritance 101. Let's go on.
Right. Let's go on the inheritance point. Generally, inheritance is not subject to tax. However, once you have inherited something and when you make the sale of that inherited property, there may be capital gains.
Okay,
however, there are a lot of cases that have, and a debate that is going on as to whether or not you have to pay tax on them, because sometimes there are some family arrangements that can be entered into and you may not be able, you may be exempted from paying tax because
so
of the family arrangement.
So what you're essentially saying is, if I have an ancestral, say an ancestral home somewhere and somebody bequeaths the entire home to me,
right,
I don't have to pay any tax on
right.
it. But if somebody sells that, right, as in divides it up, sells it, and distributes it among siblings, then I have to pay tax on it, on what I'm getting.
So I'm saying that there is a tax on the sale of that ancestral property, not necessarily dividing it.
It has been divided. At least what I understand from the question is it's been divided amongst the siblings.
And there is
and
a sale.
They are selling it.
Right.
So now he has to pay tax on
there
whatever
may be
income
a, right.
that comes in.
Right.
Okay. And how can he save on the tax?
So that's what I said, that there could be a family arrangement that could be entered into between all the siblings.
Mm-hmm.
We have seen courts to say that family arrangements may not be taxable. That is one solution that he could look into. But when it comes to ancestral property, we should understand that there are various qualifications that are added, who the property belonged to, how did it come to her. So we need to consider all of that also before making a very straight statement that there will not be any tax payable.
Okay.
Right.
But like you said, if there is a sale, there is tax to be paid.
Yes, prima facie, absolutely.
That is clear.
Yes.
That is clear. But what you're also saying is if they get into a family arrangement, you said, what is this family arrangement?
Usually, you know, the siblings can come together and enter into an agreement saying that, you know, we wish to do this together, make sale of the property.
Mm-hmm.
And there's an arrangement between them where there's a consensus of mind that they are trying to do something with the property. There may be a situation where you may not need to pay.
He's also asking about HUF. How much sense does it make? And also, you know, break it down for our viewers. What is an HUF?
Right. So an HUF is a Hindu undivided family. Usually, it is the head of the family who becomes the karta.
Hmm.
And then there are co-partners who are effectively the children of the head of the family. By a 2005 amendment, even wives and daughters were allowed to become part of the HUF.
Okay.
So from a tax perspective, HUF is considered as a separate entity. Because it is considered a separate entity, all the tax exemptions and tax deductions available to an individual are also available to an HUF. Now, this is great because if there is income that is being earned, you can have an HUF which will earn that income and get all those benefits of deductions, of exemptions that an individual was getting, the HUF can get. Also, the standard deduction of the minimum slab rate of 2.5 lakhs is also available to the HUF.
No, so in this case, if the siblings were to come together and form an HUF and then sell the property, so they pay taxes one entity, all three of them don't need to pay taxes separately? Is that how it works?
It may not work that way because we'll have to go get into how the siblings are connected and whether can an HUF be formed, if there are individual HUFs, so a lot of things. Also in this case, since it's the mother and she has no other income, an HUF may not be the most viable situation here. HUF should be normally used when there is income that is being generated. And that income can be then moved on to the HUF because then it can take those benefits.
Right.
In this case, the woman, the mother,
income.
Exactly.
Right. So HUF may not be viable because what your mother is getting is one-time income over here, and if you get into a family arrangement, so obviously for this you need to go get professional opinion, go to a tax consultant, go to lawyers. If the siblings were to come together and form a family arrangement of sorts, you could possibly save on tax. Right. We have a caller on the line. AK Malik has called in. Mr. Malik, go on. Tell us what's your question.
You see, my question is that I had bought a property about 5 years back, mm-hmm. At a cost of 1 crore.
Okay.
Now, after 5 years, now I want to sell it.
Mm-hmm.
And as per indexing, its value is 1.5 crore.
Okay.
And the actual market value is 2 crore.
Okay.
So if I sell it at 2 crore,
mm-hmm.
now the 50 lakh beyond the indexing value, that is from 1.5 crore to 2 crore, is 50 lakh difference.
Mm-hmm.
Will I have to pay the capital gain on that? Number one question.
Okay.
And another question is that to avoid that capital gain, if I have to buy another property, do I have to buy a property worth 50 lakh or 2 crore?
Okay, that's an interesting question, but he's done most of the answering himself over here. He's done a fair bit of research. 50 lakhs would be the capital gains.
Right.
Says. Does he have to buy a property for that that much to save on capital gains?
Right. So what he can do is, assuming that his property is a residential property again, he can invest the 50 lakhs into another residential property and therefore become exempt from paying capital gains on those 50 lakhs.
So 50 lakhs is what you need to invest in another residential property to avail of the deduction. Also tell us this, in case Mr. Malik has not already identified another property to reinvest the gains in,
right,
then what can he do?
So he can utilize the 50 lakhs to invest into long-term bonds.
Mm-hmm.
However, the specified limit for long-term bonds is also 50 lakhs only. He cannot invest, I mean, he will not get an exemption to invest beyond 50 lakhs. He can invest up to 50 lakhs in long-term bonds.
So if somebody gets gains more than 50 lakhs, they have to pay tax on it, is what you're saying?
Yes, or he could then invest in the remaining in the property.
In property. So Mr. Malik, that's your answer. You need to reinvest 50 lakhs, which is your gains, which is the profit that you've made, into another property. And if you have not yet identified that, then you can put it in a long-term bond. Right? Thank you very much for calling in. Let's move on. I believe we have another caller on the line. Vijay Sethi has called in. Vijay, tell us what's your question.
Good evening, madam, and I must appreciate your this effort. I have 3 residential properties on my name.
Mm-hmm.
I have 3 residential properties on my name, and I intend to sell one of these, which I had bought in 2010 at the cost of 25 lakhs. It can fetch me today about 55 to 60 lakhs.
Mm.
Now, if I sell this property and buy another one, because I own 3 properties now, residential. Buy another residential property, will I be entitled for capital gain or tax for capital gain, or I can buy the same without paying tax?
Okay, what can he do? He has 3 properties. Now, will he have to pay capital gains tax?
Yes, because he already has a residential property and therefore the exemption that is available to him by subtracting the cost of acquisition from the from the sale price, there would be a capital gains on it.
So how can he save on this? Is there a way that he can save on this? Can he reinvest it in another property, which is precisely what he's asking? If he were to buy another property, reinvest the gains, will he still have to pay capital gains tax on that?
Yes, he would have to pay capital gains tax on that because he already has a property of a residential in nature. If he did not have and he was investing into another residential property, in that case, he could have saved
the capital. So there is no tax exemption that he can avail?
No.
Right, you've reached your limit on homes, looks like, Mr. Sethi. You cannot really avail tax capital gains exemption over there.
Sorry, madam. I was hearing the earlier question. You see, because in the earlier, if I reinvest this property into a residential house.
No, that's precisely what Ashish is saying, that you already have 2 homes, right? You have 2 residential properties and there is a 3rd that you're buying. You want to sell one and invest in a bigger one, right?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
And so because you already have 2 homes, 2 residential properties, you cannot claim tax exemption for the third one.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you so much for calling in. Let's move on. We have a query coming in on email now. Karthik writes in. He says that he has two housing loans for two different properties in Bengaluru. Now, both the properties are registered in his name and he stays in a rented house in Chennai. Can he claim HRA for the house he rents as well as income tax exemption for the two properties in Bengaluru? He plans to declare the rent he receives from the properties in Bengaluru. What can he do? But you do have a limit to how much exemption you can claim, right?
Right, of course. But I think in his question, he specifies, mentioned that he is living in Chennai and he is buying properties in Bangalore. So if we assume for a minute that he is in Chennai for employment, then the HRA should be possible. Now coming to the two properties in Bangalore, with respect to the loans on the two properties, again, the one in which is the residential property, he should be able to get a 1.5 lakh deduction on the principal amount and 2 lakh deduction on the interest amount. And as I said earlier, for the second property, he's eligible to get a complete deduction of the interest that he's going to pay the bank on the second house.
Okay. So essentially, you have a lot of deduction over there. You can claim deduction for your HRA. You can claim deduction on your first house, on the interest and the principal, both. You can also claim deduction on the complete, the total interest that you're paying on your second house, which means net 100% of the interest that you're paying on the second house, you can claim as tax deduction. So you should be a happy man when you're, you know, calculating your taxes. Let's move on. Our last query comes in via email. Subish Thomas has written in and says he's a permanent resident of Canada and an Indian citizen. He wants to buy land to build a house that costs approximately 1 crore rupees. He wants to take a loan for 50 lakh rupees. He plans to rent out this house after construction. Now he says the interest rate in Canada is 6.5%, while the average base rate in India, like all of us know, 9.7%. He wants to know if he should take an NRI loan in India for tax benefits or if he should transfer funds from Canada to India. It's interesting that he's asking about tax arbitrage rather than interest rate arbitrage over here.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So on his question, I think, again, this is more of an investment decision. But the loan that he takes in India from an Indian bank will be eligible for a deduction, like we've already said before. But the loan that he takes from Canada from a Canadian bank may not be available over here as a deduction. So that is one point that he should keep in mind. Rest is a complete investment decision, as he'd like to go with it.
So it's a complete investment decision that you need to make. But one thing is very clear. If you were to take a home loan in India, then you could actually claim tax deduction on that. But you will not get tax deduction for a home loan that you take in Canada, right? With that, we come to an end of today's edition of Property Hotline. Thank you very much for all those questions. And thanks a lot, Ashish, for coming in.
Thanks for calling me in.
Right, we'll be back on Thursday with another guest who'll answer all your questions related to home finance. So keep those questions coming in, and you all know how to reach out to us. You can write into us on email, on Facebook, on our website www.mbnow.in, where you can also send in your video queries if you want to be seen and heard on this channel. You can also tweet to me, and if you want, like all the other callers that you saw on the show, you can also call in live and get your queries answered by our experts, right? Thank you very much for watching Property Hotline. Continue watching Magicbricks Now.